Week 16 parlays and player props are back. We got four player props and one money line parlay coming your way. Yo, what's going on, everyone? This is Austin from Calling Our Shot. I gotta first say Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays to everyone out there. Now, over the past 7 weeks, this video alone, 21-7, we've been on an absolute tear. And the money line parlay cashed last week. It cashed two of the last 3 weeks. It would have been 3 for 3, but the Bengals screwed us 2 weeks ago. But we're gonna keep getting into it. If you happen to be stumbled upon the Calling Our Shot channel for the first time, consider clicking that subscribe button down below. We not only do this video every single Saturday night, but we have tons of other daily NBA videos, a bunch of other NFL content coming your guys' way. And if we, maybe by the time you're watching this, we might have already hit 17,000 subscribers. If we have, let's get to 18,000. If we haven't, consider hit that subscribe button, be our 17,000 subscriber. Click the like button too. But let's keep getting into it. Let's, as always, do your research and let's get into my first play of the day. We're going with Ezekiel Elliott under 54.5 rushing yards, minus 120. Now, if you drafted Ezekiel Elliott in fantasy football, more than likely, you're probably sitting on the couch because he has been a major disappointment so far this season, not only in fantasy football, but just in regular football as a whole. Since week 7, he hasn't hit this over. He's gone under in 8 straight games, including a matchup against the team that he'll be playing on Sunday, the Washington football team. Now, I got to give him credit, at least a little bit of credit, because he does get close to this line. It's not like he's putting up 10 rushing yards in a game. He's had games of 50, 51, 52 rushing yards, but in this season, let's be honest, we've seen Zeke and we've shown his age, and he just doesn't have that same speed and athleticism that we've really been used to seeing out of him throughout the majority of his career. And we've seen his backup, Tony Pollard, come in and show a lot more juice, a lot more speed, a lot more athleticism, versatility, agility, you name it. He's been much better. And so that's why people are like, what are they going to do with Zeke Elliott in the offseason? We're not concerned about that. We're only concerned about today and week 16 matchup against the Washington football team, which is a much more favorable matchup for the pass catchers of the Dallas Cowboys. Washington football team currently gives up the eighth least rushing yards per game in the NFL. And that includes a game last week that they gave up over 200 rushing yards to the Philadelphia Eagles. This team's going to come in motivated, want to stop the run, because that's how you beat the Cowboys first. You got to stop that run. And Ezekiel Elliott gone under in 3 straight games for Washington. And Amari Cooper, speaking of the pass catchers, Amari Cooper even voiced his concern, saying that the Dallas Cowboys would be much better if they targeted him a little bit more. So I expect him to see some extra targets today. Maybe we'll see Ezekiel Elliott lose a little bit of carries. I'm all in. I'll take Zeke to go under 54.5 rushing yards. Now, last note, sharper books have this line, this under at over minus 152, I believe. So a great positive expected value bet that will ride with our first play of the day. Let's get into our second play of the day. This guy has been an absolute wagon to people that are betting his overs all season. Cooper Kupp, we're taking his over 105.5 receiving yards, minus 115 on DraftKings. I mean, what do you want me to do here? Take an under? The guy's been an absolute machine. This Kupp to Stafford connection has been unstoppable. It's been ridiculous. They could tell you, hey, we're throwing it to Kupp in the slot, and you can't stop it. That's how good they have been so far this season. And he's chasing 2,000. He's going for 2,000 receiving yards. I believe 300, a little over 300 away from it. He could be the first receiver to ever do that in NFL history. The most ever, Calvin Johnson with 1,964. And of course, Calvin Johnson's QB that season was Matthew Stafford. So you look at it, Kupp has had 136, 123, and 129 receiving yards his last 3 games. He's hit this over in 6 of the last 8 games as all overall. And the 2 games he missed, not like he didn't give you a show. He put on 96 and 95 receiving yards, just 1 catch short. Now the matchup against the Vikings, arguably as good as it gets. Minnesota allows the 4th most receiving yards per game to opposing teams, and that includes the 2nd most receiving yards to opposing wide receivers as a whole. The only team that's allowed more receiving yards total than the Minnesota Vikings this season is the Tennessee Titans, and they played a whole game more than the Minnesota Vikings. So depending on Sunday's matchup, they could very well end up being the team with the most receiving yards allowed to opposing wide receivers. I'll ride with Kupp again today. He's been an absolute wagon. Like I said, he's been unstoppable, and I think they're chasing these record books, and I think they're going to keep pouring it into him. And that the greatest thing about him is they could tell you, like I said, they could tell you who they're throwing it to. Whatever you want to do. The Kupp has been ridiculous. Like they can put him wherever they want. He's a great route runner. They disguise where he lines up, and he's just been getting the ball nonstop, 9 to 15 targets a game. We'll ride with him over 105.5 receiving yards. Moving on to another play, it's a little bit of a tricky one. T. Higgins, we're taking his over 24.5 longest reception. So that means he has to get a reception of 25 yards or longer, or else this bet does not cash. But I have faith in him, minus 110 versus Caesars. Now, prior to last week, the Bengals' offense was really humming along. T. Higgins was really getting into a groove. He had 114, 138, and 114 receiving yards in his prior 3 games. Then the Broncos came in and just slapped him, and it was just a weird offensive game for the Bengals. They'd end up winning outright, but still, he only had 23 receiving yards. Jamar Chase had a bad day. Joe Mixon had a bad day. Everyone had a bad day, really except for Tyler Boyd, who got a 1 long catch in the game. But Like I said, in those three previous games when he did really well, had over 100 receiving yards, wouldn't you know, T. Higgins hit this over in all three of them. He had 27, 29, and 32 yard completions in all, or receptions in all three, cashing easily in all three of those games. Now today, he takes on the Baltimore Ravens. So this is a team they play twice a year. And obviously he played them earlier this season. And he had 7 receptions on 15 targets for 62 yards. And his long reception, only 11 yards. So it was a weird game plan for him. That was mainly because his teammate was having a field day. Jamar Chase, 8 receptions for over 200 yards against that Baltimore Ravens secondary. Now, despite them being even more banged up at cornerback than they were that matchup, I still think they are going to try to shut him down a little bit more than they did in the first one. But it doesn't help, though, that the Ravens defensive coordinator did come out and disrespect Jamar Chase a little bit this week. He said last week you saw the Ravens take on the Packers. They were double teaming, triple teaming Devontae Adams. And he said the Ravens defensive coordinator, kind of verbatim, I'm kind of paraphrasing, he said they don't need to do that to Chase this week. He's not in the same caliber or stratosphere of Devontae Adams. He just is not a guy that they need to double team. And while I don't disagree with that, I'm not going to say Chase is better than Adams. That's ridiculous. Adams probably the best wide receiver in the NFL. Maybe Cooper Kupp's trying to at least put his name into that jar, but still, you probably don't get away with saying that. You're going to get the Bengals all fired up, and I just could see Chase having a good day. But T. Higgins still, all we need is one catch, and the reason we're really here, Baltimore Ravens, they've allowed the most 20-plus yard completions in the NFL this season. They've allowed 61 total, and all we're asking for one is from T. Higgins to get 20-plus, just maybe get 5 more yards, get to 25, maybe even a 30-yard. I mean, you think about T. Higgins, he's a down-to-the-field guy with Jamar Chase going deep. He might be doing those intermediate crossers, easily getting over 25 to 30 yard receptions. He's going to see 4 to 5 targets in this kind of character, or you know, that this kind of range of on the field. I think he gets it done. We're riding with T. Higgins over 24 and a half yards for his longest reception. Moving on to my last player prop of the video before we get into the money line parlay, where we're going for 2 straight and 3 of our last 4. Doing Noah Fant over 39 and a half receiving yards plus 100. Now Drew Lock is starting at QB for the Broncos. They're taking on the Raiders, and Teddy Bridgewater obviously not active. And truthfully, I think this might actually help Fant to produce, because you know, you think about with Teddy Bridgewater in there, he was much more, you know, throwing it around to a bunch of different people. They're going to be a much different offense under Drew Lock. I think they're going to run it a lot, and they already are running it a lot with Javonte Williams and Melvin Gordon. But I don't think they'll be throwing it deep as much as they might have been doing to Cortland Sutton, Tim Patrick, Jerry Jeudy. It's going to be a lot more. They're not letting Drew Lock unleash the cannon, especially not on the road against the Raiders. So that's going to be a lot more conservative throws, and that means a lot more to Fant and whatever the other tight end guy that I cannot pronounce his last name. Now, with lucky for us, Fant and Lock, they have a pretty good connection. They've showed that throughout their career. Now, you saw Fant easily hit this over last week, but in 15 games that Lock has started and Fant obviously has played in, or Lock has at least played in those games, he didn't necessarily need to start, but he at least played in. You see Fant going over this line in 11 of those 15 games. He's a very good security blanket. We've seen games where Lock will throw for 132 passing yards. Well, Fant will have 68 of them. Like, this is the kind of caliber of connection these two have. And I just think he's going to be that security blanket. The guys that he's going to target if he's ever under duress. He's not going to be throwing the ball deep too much down the field. And you look at this matchup, it is very, very good against this Raiders team. They're currently giving up the 5th most receiving yards to the tight end position. And we saw Fant earlier this season, he had 97 receiving yards versus them. And last year, when Lock actually started versus the Raiders, he had 48 receiving yards. I'm all in. The Raiders have allowed 8 tight ends to hit this over, with several more coming in the high 30s. So I'll ride with it. Plus 100 value. Count me in. Sign me up. I'm taking Noah Fant over 39 and a half receiving yards. Now let's move in. Let's get into the money line parlay. That's the reason you guys are here. We're going for 2 straight, 3 of our last 4. And here are the 4 teams. Last week we rode with the Bills, Cowboys, Packers, Steelers. Cash that. This week it was a sweaty one. This week we're going with the Buccaneers, the Ravens, the Broncos, and the Chiefs. Plus 703. $100 to win 700. So sprinkle on this, because let's talk about each leg. Now the Buccaneers, they take on the Panthers. And despite their offense, they'll be down Mike Evans, Chris Godwin, Leonard Fournette. Still 10-point favorites. Vegas giving them a lot of respect. And this is Cam Newton that we're talking about, or whoever the heck the Panthers are starting at QB. Panthers can't score. And you can ask the Bucs last week, you can't win if you can't score. So I think that when you look at the Bucs defense really turning corners, they need that offense kind of to kick back into gear. And I think they'll be able to do it today or on Sunday. Now the Ravens, by far the sketchiest leg on this one. Now, sure, I already picked a T. Higgins over. And sure, that you could maybe say the Bengals should win this one outright. And I don't blame you, but here we are. The Ravens were my upset pick on the podcast. If you haven't checked it out, go check it. Now, Look, I know the Bengals are a good team, but I've yet to see them win a big game so far, and I just don't know if they're really capable. They're a super young team. They really haven't gone through a ton of adversity, and this Baltimore Ravens team has been up and down. They've lost two games on two-point conversions alone. This team could have a much better record, and I'm not necessarily the biggest Ravens homer. I like Tyler Huntley. I think he should be starting at QB again today, but I still think you look at this Ravens team. They're gritty. They're going to grind this one out, and I think they got a chance. They got embarrassed last time these two teams played, losing, I think, 41-17. That was, I believe, at Baltimore. This one's in Cincinnati. Just have a weird feeling that Tyler Huntley and the Ravens pull it off, get the win, and almost clinch up this AFC North division. So I'll ride with them. Now the next leg, Broncos, they're taking on the Raiders. It's the late, the great Demaryius Thomas's birthday on Christmas, so they'll be playing on the 26th, though. And you just look at the Broncos. This defense is super good, and they're going to be fired up knowing that they got to kind of carry this team against Derek Carr. I'm not a big fan of the Raiders. I think they're a little bit of a fraud. Their record's a little too good. I think they're due a loss, and I'm thinking of taking the Broncos, even though they're on the road, starting Drew Lock. I'll ride with them and Noah Fant. Now the last leg, the Chiefs take the Steelers at home, and as a person that's watched enough of the Steelers offense, I can confirm they are god awful. They are terrible, and I will not be taking their spread or money line ever again. That team cannot move the ball to save their lives. The Chiefs on a roll, and they're trying to clinch this number one seed in the division. Patrick Mahomes really yet to really catch into that groove and really look like the Mahomes of late, but I still think they get it done. So those are my four teams we're obviously rocking with. We got the Buccaneers, the Ravens, the Broncos, and the Chiefs, all four of those teams to win, plus 703 odds. I love it. Let's see if we can get two straight. And I appreciate you. If you want to check out my NBA best bets, I believe that video is already over. So I appreciate you guys for tuning in. This will be the only video. We'll have an NBA best bets tomorrow morning, so you can check that out. It'll be linked down below in the description. Appreciate you guys. Let's have a great week 16 in the NFL. Let's go for another profitable week. And if you're new to the community, consider clicking that subscribe and that like button. We appreciate you guys. I'll see you in the next one. Peace.